This video is brought to you by the community. Thank you to my channel members for your continued support. Hello guys and welcome back to the channel. Today we're going to go over my fleet again. Now about 7 months ago I made a fleet video, and as you can see on screen now, that was how it stood at that particular moment in time. Since then it has changed, manipulated, manifested into a whole new animal, courtesy of Star Citizen producing some new and interesting ships, and the likes of Invictus and IAE. It has changed somewhat, however, there are some classics that I've said in the previous video would stay here in this fleet, and they still are. And we'll start with the Banu Merchantman. So, as previously mentioned, this ship will never leave my fleet. Do I intend to crew it? Probably not. Will I find crew for it? Probably not. Is it going to be extremely difficult to operate this ship? Yes, absolutely. But I'm not deterred by it, because I am infatuated with the BMM. I think it's a fantastic looking ship. It has tons of versatility, has decent firepower, vehicle bay, a monstrous 2000 SCU, two size 8 guns on the nose, the animations for the top turret, everything about this ship is pretty awesome. A hangar for light fighters, so it has a lot going for it. Now, I do have, I think, a fairly robust idea of how I intend to use this ship strategy-wise. Again, I'm going to keep that close to my chest because I think it's such a good idea. I don't want any competition. Whether or not I can pull it off, I don't know. But the ship itself is very popular throughout the verse. It looks incredible. It's stopped production at the moment, which is fine, because at least we know they've got a good platform to carry on working on this ship when production restarts. But from everything I've seen recently, it's looking pretty special. It's been through numerous concept changes. Some prefer the sort of spiky old school look that it had. I actually kind of prefer this rounded off, smoother look to the Merchantman personally. I do feel as well that Origin should be worried, because even though this is a massive, massive sort of market freight ship, it is still elegant. Very elegant for a ship of this side. So it'd be interesting to see if Origin can produce something similar or to compete with this ship, because it's very, very sort of flash and quite ornate, delicate interior that the Banu are familiar with using for their ships. So it's going to have some very intricate designs internally. Outside, as you can see now, we do start to see some of the etchings and some of that delicacy coming through on the Merchantman. Although not fully complete yet, obviously it's got a lot of work to be done on it before it reaches its full potential, but I think it's going to be an absolutely amazing ship. Like I said, my only concerns are crewing it and using it is going to be an immense struggle. I am under no illusion whatsoever that this will be a very difficult ship to operate, but I just don't care, because sometimes it's just about how something makes you feel, right? You don't buy a Ferrari to take the kids to school. You do it to drive it on the country roads and drive it like a maniac and get a thrill from it. I think that's kind of why I've stuck to my guns with this ship. Logically, it makes no sense whatsoever for me to keep a ship of this size in my fleet. But you know what? I just don't care. It remains, it will remain in my fleet permanently. So that is my reason behind the BMM. It's just a fantastic ship, and I cannot wait to have it arrive and visit this ship for the first time. And when I make a video on it, it will be a very long video, even movie-like, because I love this ship so much. Okay, so that's the BMM. Some of the reasons why I'm keeping it, although there's no logic behind it, it stays. Next up then is the mighty, mighty Polaris. Now, I have had a very on-off relationship with this ship, i.e. I've bought it, melted it, bought it, melted it, bought it, over and over and over again. So why do I have it now? Well, one, it's being built, and I want to experience that Corvette life, right? I need to get in this ship and experience it. Again, this is another ship that might be on the chopping block. This might actually end up on the chopping block, because I am under, again, no illusions whatsoever. Manning this is going to be an issue. There's only so much blades and NPCs are going to be able to do for you. it very much depends what use I can get from this ship. Now, predominantly solo. That doesn't mean I play solo all the time. I do have friends. We recently did a community event for the Siege of Orison in my Discord. If you wish to join my Discord and come join this community, link in the description. So there are ways around it. I'm sure some of the community would love to swap and crew each other's ships. That's something we've been discussing. But yes, I've owned it, disowned it, owned it, disowned it. Now, don't get me wrong, this ship is incredible. It is absolutely incredible. It offers a lot in terms of versatility and the roles it's going to fulfill. The firepower alone is enough to entice people into purchasing one. It's a very popular ship, and now it's in production. The wheels are turning. Within 12 months, we could all be in Polaris's causing mayhem. So that is something I want to experience. It does have some unique roles, you know, search and rescue as well. It has the ship hangar, which is always going to be useful. Med bay, brig, cargo area. Obviously, a ridiculous amount of torpedoes. So, whether or not I get the full potential out of this ship, which I hope I do, this could be on the chopping block. If I have to melt this, it will be for a Liberator and probably a Crucible. I'm waiting to see what the Crucible rework will be before I come to that decision, but I definitely want to experience this ship before I come to any of those decisions, because the Polaris is awesome. Don't get me wrong. It just might be extremely difficult for me to operate. Okay, moving up to the next ship. Now, this is another one, the Nautilus. This one I've owned quite a few times. Bought it, melt it, bought it, melt it. I actually think that this ship is going to be very useful. There's something that draws me to this ship every single time. Right, I really like the way it looks. I think it's incredible. I really think it just looks amazing, this particular ship. The fact that it has different mines that we're going to be able to put out with the ship, I think will be extremely useful as well, especially now that base building is going to be a thing. Having mines around your base is never going to be a bad idea. But I also think this ship is well equipped enough to become some sort of patrol boat, gunboat. It's got the firepower, you know. It's six-man crew again, I think. Off the top of my head, I might be wrong on that. I think it's six-man crew. Six-man crew is awesome. Hopefully we could have, like, I could pay for four NPCs, have two of them flying it, two of them doing other stuff, and then shove some blades in the turret. And then we've got an operational ship. So I do think there's going to be uses for the Nautilus. I like the way it looks. I like the crew size. A couple of sentry drones around my base, or my airspace of my base, is almost certainly going to be useful, depending on how powerful they decide to make them, or even the magnetic mines, something of that nature, for that peace of mind. So I do think there are some good uses for this ship. And it's a ship that never, ever sells out. I'm kind of intrigued as to why it doesn't, because I do think there will be uses. There are some people that sit on the fence with it. I think there are roles to be filled with this ship, and it looks really good. I've always been drawn to the Nautilus. I think it looks fantastic. Let's just hope I can get the uses out of it, and with the NPCs and the blades, maybe we've got a very, very good ship on our hand for mine laying, choke points, for example, jump points. If I end up somewhere through a jump point and decide to, I don't know, throw my hat down and make my base in and around that area, then having a minefield around a jump point exit could be a very useful and tactful strategy, just to give me a little bit more of extra protection. I think the biggest problem with this ship is its price. For an extra, I think it's $25 or $30, you can literally pick up a Polaris. It's the price point that I think this ship struggles. You know, if it was $50, maybe $60 cheaper than the Polaris, I think that would be a bit more sort of positive for this ship. $25 is, for the Polaris, you just get so much more versatility. This is very niche, this ship, but however, it's staying now. I've got it, it's staying, I'm sticking with it. I do think I'll get some uses out of this ship, even if I have to mine other people's bases for them and make a profit. That is an option. So there are definitely roles I could dream up. I'm not going to bore you with them, because we need to move on to the next ship, which of course is the mighty Arestra. Now, this ship is, quite honestly, just amazing. Very, very versatile, excellent mining ship. Good crew size again. 5-man crew, I believe. This is almost certainly going to prove useful. If I need materials for base building, if I need materials to sell, if I need materials for whatever other manner of reasons that I might need said minerals and ores, etc., then the Arestra is going to have me covered. External carrying capacity for cargo is an ingenious touch. An internal storage and an onboard refinery make for good times. Not to mention, I really like the look of this ship. They've really carried over the RSI flavor, especially with the engine nacelles at the back that are so similar to that of the Perseus. It's a very sleek looking ship, which they tried to make look a bit more industrial, which you can see elements of, but I still think for a mining ship it is without a doubt one of the most sleek looking mining ships in the game. It has advantages over the Orion. Being able to land, for example, is a huge plus. That external carrying capacity for cargo and ore, it has a lot going for it, this ship. It was too good of a ship for me to just turn my nose up with, especially if I can get it working well in tandem with that of the Galaxy. I think this ship, yeah, it's just going to be extremely useful to have something like this in the fleet. I can see me using it quite often, even as a basic moneymaker, a fund grabbing machine to fund the fleet, then of course the Arestra is going to be very much capable of that. I look forward to seeing this in the pipeline when we start getting grey box and white box and a few more extra details of this ship. I think a lot of people were very surprised by the ship. I know I certainly was. Wasn't expecting it to look the way it looks, and I wasn't expecting it to have just the features that it has. The refinery is a huge, huge time saver. Makes it extremely useful. Gather in those supplies, throw them into the Galaxy, get the base building module working in the Galaxy, and then boom, off we go. And anything else I need, I'm pretty much covered for. So it's a very versatile ship, has tons of utility, has a lot going for it, and that is why it's in my fleet. Even if it's just for basic accumulation of money, that's fine by me, because you know this fleet isn't going to pay for itself, right? There's a cost to everything in the fleet, and this is a great way to generate money if I need it. Besides the usual sort of missions, bounty hunting, etc., then this ship is almost certainly going to prove this worth. I think it's a keeper. I can't see me melting this. I think the Orion is far too much of an animal for me to have, personally. It's an absolute monstrosity, that ship. It's absolutely huge and is space-bound. You won't be able to land with it. So I just don't need it. This fits the crew needs as well, which is perfect. So we get a fairly decent utilitarian ship here, which is going to prove its worth, make me some money, and just help the fleet along nicely. That's the plan with this ship. Yeah, very impressive ship. Let's then move on to the Galaxy, as we can see here. Let's get this slotted in, like so. The Galaxy, then. Recently made a video on this. The base builder. So we know that this is going to be able to produce small to large buildings. We don't know what that entails or what encompasses a small to large building, but that would be more than enough for myself and a group of friends or members of my community, etc. So it's going to be awesome. I'm very much looking forward to this ship, even more now that we have base building. It's something I cannot wait to experience and dive into for the first time. Now, the ship itself looks absolutely fantastic. And as I said in the Galaxy video, I wasn't really interested in at first, because we had the cargo modules in the back. We had the refining modules in the back, and we have a hospital variant. But at the time, I didn't really need any of those things. Then CitizenCon happened, and then that all changed immediately. It is going to be a useful ship. I think modular ships, when they start to develop the modules like on a more grander scale, think of the Endeavour, those kinds of ships, even the Carrack, the Caterpillar, for example, Having ships with modules is going to be useful, especially when we're able to buy those modules in game and swap and completely re-outfit a ship to fit a particular role that you want said ship to do within your fleet is, I think, too good of an opportunity to miss and give up, because I get bored quite quickly as well. On, like, I don't just stick to one profession. I want to be able to mix and match. So one day I'll do mining, one day I'll do medical rescues, another day bounty hunting, etc, etc. So having that flexibility built into a ship with the modules is always going to be a benefit. So the Galaxy has that. We have the cargo module, refining module, and hospital module at the moment, which is great. And then we're going to get the base building module, which is obviously superb. So again, looks brilliant. 6-man crew, I believe. So that fills that role nicely. A couple of NPCs and some blades. I think we're good to go. And I'm starting to believe in the NPC system a bit more, because CIG have conquered server meshing. Arguably, one of the biggest hurdles they had to conquer, and they've done it. It actually works. So the fact that they've done that leads me to believe, well, if they can do that, then they're definitely going to get the NPCs working. So that's pretty awesome. So let's pretend that I've built said base with the Galaxy using the materials acquired from the Arastra. Then what do I do with the Galaxy? Well, I think I would probably outfit it with the hospital module and just have it planet side by my base for medical emergencies alongside the Apollo, should the reason need. There shouldn't be any particular reason why I couldn't have the Galaxy just sat there as a standby sort of built-in hospital by my base. I mean, bad things are going to happen, obviously, and the ability to just run into the Galaxy and quickly heal myself, I think, is a very valid option. So there are still, even planet side doing nothing, there are options that the Galaxy provides to me in the fleet. Moving on then, we come to the Odyssey. I love this ship. I really enjoy the way it looks. It looks and screams sci-fi to me. As I said in the previous My Fleet video, I can imagine Ridley Scott just going mental with an Aliens film. This is the kind of marine ship. I can see marines on this ship causing mayhem. I just love how this ship looks aesthetically. It looks incredible. The ability to refuel itself with the mining cockpit located just under the chin of the ship, and the onboard refinery, which converts the quantanium directly into the fuel tanks of the Odyssey, making fueling less of an issue. However, quantanium is quite rare, so it might be tricky to do that at the moment. Since the changes, quantanium's become quite a rare resource to gather. So it could still be tricky, but the idea is I want to take this out as my predominant explorer. You know, it has some excellent features. Med bay, decent cargo, hangars. Obviously, the ability to refine its own fuel is almost certainly going to be useful. Kind of removes that necessity to find other players to use their starfarers, because, like I said in the previous video, not everyone is trustworthy, and I don't really want to interact with strangers if I can help it while I'm out exploring, because you don't know what people's motives are. Not everyone is, of course, hostile, but then not everyone is nice. So I kind of like that aspect of having that self-reliance of the Odyssey. So we have the hangar, which is a huge plus. Now, I did contemplate having a tracker in there. I still might, the Hornet tracker or a Terrapin. I don't know how I feel about that at the moment. I think some of the best times you can have in gaming are when the happy accidents happen. So I'm kind of sitting on the fence. I might just throw the F8C Lightning in the back of that ship for the meantime. Next up then is my favorite combat ship, and one that's quite popular in our Discord, is the Perseus. This thing looks incredible. I love it. It's amazing. It's got fascinating lore. It's heavily armored. It is a beast in its own right. There are a few minor issues, I think, with this ship. The turret coverage at the back is fairly weak. For a point defense, maybe you might get some use out of it, but I do kind of feel it's a little bit vulnerable to fighters. The top turret is obviously fine. The bottom one behind the engine nacelles is very, very lackluster. That might cause a few issues, but four size sevens, bespoke cannons. So it's going to be interesting what ammunition the ship gets, but it is extremely tough. Very well armored, responsible, I think, for killing a Vandal destroyer. So it has the pedigree. It's proven itself already in combat. It's an absolute weapon. And as it's an RSI ship, I expect to see this being built after the Polaris, maybe after the Arastra, something like that. It's not a big ship. It's 100 meters long. I do expect there will some be change. Of course, there's going to be some changes to it. Couldn't tell you what there'll be, but I expect there will be. I wouldn't be surprised if this ship grows in size a little bit, because 100 meters isn't very big, but it's okay. Six-man crew again, but I just like and adore the look of this thing. And you can see the engine nacelles share that look with the Arastra, right? So that's what I was referring to earlier. They've kept that design over between the two ships, and it works really well. It's a very, very potent but tiny ship in the grand scheme of ships in this game. So I do expect this to be a fleet defender. So I will be in this if I feel threatened or there are other ships in the area that pose a significant threat. The Perseus is going to be able to offer some protection against that. That is why it's in my fleet. I will get use out of it. I'm 100% sure of that. That is what it's there for. The Polaris will be there as well. Again, sitting on the fence with the Polaris, I really just need to see how that plays out. But the Perseus is staying because I know I can crew it, and I will get some effective use out of it, because it is it's a ship with some fancy lore behind it, and has proven its worth. And this ship will never leave because it's just far too cool. The rule of cool does apply to the Perseus. Next up, then, we have my luxury explorer. Not everywhere is going to be hostile, and sometimes I like to just fly around and just chill and enjoy the game. And what a better place to do it than the classic 600i. It looks absolutely incredible with the Best in Show skin on and the Fortuna paint. The green one looks really nice on this ship. And this ship, of course, is going to have a rework. It's going to have a med bay. Thank you very much. Yes, please. We'll take one of those. So externally, it's going to keep that classic look that we're all very used to. But internally, it's going to be gutted and reworked, and I think it's going to be a very special ship once we get round to that point in time. Because as it stands at the moment, the 600i was criticised quite a lot. There is a lot of empty space in this ship, unfortunately. That's all going to change. And from the concept images, we're going to have like an armory room, I believe. Don't quote me on that. I'm pretty sure I saw an army room. And med bay is definitely going to be welcome. So it will improve drastically internally. What I like about this ship is it's so easy to run solo. Now resource management is obviously going to play a huge factor in all of these ships for anybody. It will be difficult to deal with damages happening to your ship, etc. You're going to have to run around like a blue ass fly, which is why I'm kind of hoping that we can have NPCs flying the ship, maybe manning a few turrets. That'll allow me to run around like a lunatic doing what I can to fix the ship. If I don't, then I die. Which is fine, it's all part of the experience. I can't wait for this. This game is going to get crazy, and I cannot wait for that day to come, because it's going to be awesome. But the benefits of the 600i, of course, are, you know, 90% of the weapon systems are at the pilot's control, which is nice. Three size fives, various missiles. I can't remember the exact size of them, but we have plenty of weapons and missiles, and then two remote turrets. So 90% of the time, I can operate the ship, kill things with ease. If it's AI, of course, taking on players in fighters is ill-advised. But it's doable. This ship is extremely comfortable, and it will be luxurious just to cruise and peruse around the verse, some of the nicer planets, for that chill time. 600i stays, always will. Infatuated with the ship, I think it looks great, especially in the new paint. So this is my sort of go exploring a little bit, chill out, have a good time explorer. We'll do it in style with the 600i. Next up then, the mighty Drake Cat. Now this is one of my favourite ships, as I said in the previous fleet video. So why is it one of my favourite ships? This ship for me, it has something about it. When you get in the Caterpillar for the first time, it just puts a smile on your face because it has some sort of charisma over you. It's very bizarre, but it does make me smile flying this ship. It is fantastic. Not only does it give me that sort of I love this ship vibe, the fact that it's going to be modular in the future is going to be absolutely awesome as well. Two tractor beams, I think, off the top of my head, could be wrong there. I think it is two. The fact that it's modular is going to be extremely useful because I intend to use this ship planet side, if I don't need it for any other activities, as like a mobile workstation. So I might have a vehicle repair bay installed in one, then a science lab if that's something that comes about, or a research lab, or whatever modules they decide to have. Maybe even a mobile brig I could have. Maybe someone lands on my base, tries to give me shit, and, you know, they lose. They go to jail. I can throw them in there. Throw him in the cat. This ship, even planet side, will have multiple uses for me on the fleet. I kind of like the idea of having a vehicle repair bay, maybe two of them next to each other, installed as modules on this ship so I can repair my ground vehicles. Just drive it straight in, and that would be extremely useful. Of course, it's also pretty handy in space now. You know, it's been used numerous times as a cracker pillar. You've seen that. We've all seen these full of Furies. It's a fantastic ship, really does put a smile on my face. And of course, in the future, the cockpit itself is a dedicated ship, so that would attach. So that's another aspect of the ship that I look forward to, because that will almost certainly have some uses for me at some point, even if it's just running away bravely, which I do quite a lot. Next up then is the Corsair. Now, I have been flying this ship a ridiculous amount lately, alongside the F8C. There's something very endearing about this ship. It's obviously, people talk about the firepower. Yes, of course, it's got ample firepower. I just like the fact that it gives you so many things. It has so many uses, you know, like you bounty hunting is easy with this. Easy, you just melt literally everything. The fact that it has cargo and can take a vehicle is also a huge plus. It's just so unique, this ship. I love the bridge, I love the co-pilot seats. I just, the whole experience of owning a Corsair never gets old. Obviously the wings that fold in and out is a very, very cool animation to work with. It can be tricky to land because of its sort of snub-nosed, snubby little landing gear. It can be quite tricky to land on uneven surfaces, but the ship is just great. It's so versatile, the ability to just melt any ship really that tries to give you a problem. But I sort of intend to use this as a ship for planet to planet exploration in areas that I feel could be quite hostile. So obviously Pyro is the first thing that comes to mind. I feel like traveling from Pyro 1 to Pyro 2 in a ship that's more than capable of dishing out some serious DPS, easy to fly, has respectable range, with the correct components and stuff, it's going to prove useful. Next up then, we have the Zeus Mark II MR. This is for bounty hunting 2.0. I really want to utilize what this ship has on offer. I really want to use the quantum dampening and the EMP effects of this ship to its full capability. Now, I'm sure CRG have probably learnt the lessons from the release of the Antares, where you would sit on the back and press a button in order to operate the EMP, etc. This is 1-3 crew, so still very doable. I'm looking forward to seeing what this ship will fulfil in my role. Obviously, having a quantum damper and an EMP is always going to be useful, right? In any sort of interaction with hostile NPCs, AI, and or players, having a ship with those capabilities is something I was interested in. I'm waiting for a bit more detail on this ship before I produce a video on it. Maybe some progress from CRG. When we get a bit more sort of detail of the internals and stuff, then I can get a bit more of a better idea. I like the look of this ship. It looks very, very, very sleek, very Dorito. Let's be honest, something that RSI are quite fond of, apparently. You've only got to look at the Polaris, but it does look really cool. And this particular paint scheme for the MR is, really good. And I'm pretty sure the other variants might actually get a look in as well. We'll have to see, but that's predominantly going to be my dedicated bounty hunting, bringing criminals to justice, or people that have done me wrong the Zeus Mark II is there for that reason. Then we move on to the Star Runner. This is another ship that will never leave the fleet. I really enjoy this ship. It's a great daily driver, plenty of SCU for its size. The data running capability, when that becomes a thing in the game, it's another avenue I can take this ship out, explore the verse, make some revenue, can take friends with you, NPCs, you know, it's a very well designed ship internally. It's very pleasant to be in. It's a just fantastic ship with the secret, quote unquote, air quotes, secret drug running undercarriage area of the ship. It has a lot going for it. Asymmetrical in design. It's a very, very cool looking ship. Flies really well. It's really fast. Just a great daily driver, to be honest with you. There's nothing wrong with cruising around in the verse in the Star Runner. Although it doesn't have its main role in game as the Data Runner, it's still an excellent, excellent ship. Not really a bounty hunting ship. Doesn't mean you can't do it, but it is still an excellent and superb daily driver. The Star Runner is fairly popular for good reason. Never leaving my fleet. I've always loved this ship. Looks fantastic with all different paints, especially I think it was the blue Best in Show paint from a few years ago. The ship looks absolutely great and it's a very popular ship for good reason. So this will never leave because I do want something to have that extra flexibility when making UEC around the verse with the data running. Then I've got the Star Runner. We don't know how much we'll get for that. I have no idea. It's completely irrelevant. I just want that sort of experience and another option to complete another, be able to partake, I should say, another game loop within the verse. And the Star Runner does that very well. Next up then, we have the F8C Lightning. Now this thing is a complete and utter freaking animal and I love it. I've been absolutely having a blast in this thing. If you want a good time with this ship, just throw on 6 distortion repeaters and have 2 badges. That's what I've been doing, and it's a very fun and pleasant experience watching ships literally shut down and fall planet side and blow up. You don't even have to shoot them. It's fantastic. Even with very high risk targets, you can still have good times with the amount of DPS this ship is capable of pushing out. It looks incredible, a little bit controversial when it was released into the game, but I don't pay attention to any of that nonsense because life is too short. I snap one up straight away. It's a fantastic ship. I think I will throw that in the back of my Odyssey because, like I said originally, the Odyssey doesn't have the scanners like the Carrick does, for example. But thinking about it, some of the best moments in gaming for me are when you bump into things or accidentally stumble across such a thing that creates a whole scenario. So I'm more inclined to throw the F8C in the back of my Odyssey for that extra, if something goes wrong, then we have a formidable heavy fighter sat in the hangar of the Odyssey, ready to respond and put up, let's be honest, a fairly decent fight against what it might be that's trying to give you grief in any shape or form. Then the Lightning is certainly a valid option, because it's ridiculous in terms of firepower. No co-pilot required, which is very nice. So getting in this and scrambling to a situation where you feel threatened, the Lightning is going to suit that very well. Again, I'm still on the fence about it. I still might pick up a Hornet Tracker. Maybe I don't quite like the Zeus for whatever reason, or it doesn't fit the fleet. Then the Hornet Tracker, I think, would be an option. But the FHC is an animal all to itself, and this is definitely staying. This is a LTI ship as well, I fly this often. It's fantastic, and honestly, if you want a good time, try 6 distortions and just kill things with 2 badges. It's ridiculously good fun. Highly recommend it. Next then, we have the Apollo Medevac. I like these ships. They look really, really cool. They really do. I really like and appreciate the design of the Apollos. I think they look absolutely superb. So what is this ship going to fulfill in its role in my fleet? It's just going to be an excellent ambulance, maybe transferring patients to and from. It's going to be the Medevac variant, I believe, has thicker armor, so it's going to be a little bit more tolerable when it comes to taking a beating from whatever situation you're in. It has numerous medical beds, which are going to be extremely useful. Like I said, even if I have the Galaxy parked planet side with a hospital module in the back, and something happens, I can call on this Apollo to either rescue someone, bring them back straight to the RSI Galaxy. I think also, as medical gameplay develops and starts getting into a better place, I still think it needs work. It's still on the cusp of, you get shot and you die immediately, more than I would like to. I would like the injuries to appear more than actually just dying straight away. So I still think medical gameplay has still got some work, for sure. And having a space ambulance is going to be extremely useful. It has multiple beds of varying tiers, and of course it does have a sort of hover hospital bed that you can deploy from the ship, and it would go down planet side or maybe to another vessel, possibly extract that individual, put them on said hover bed, let's call it that, and retrieve them into the ship. So that's a cool and very interesting mechanic. Not entirely sure how that will work, but I am looking forward to it. It's the same with the drones. Drones in the game, when we start getting drones, the Carrick has drones, the Nautilus has drones. Surely these are all going to have a very useful purpose. I certainly think they will. And I imagine if they can get the drones working, which I believe they will, because they got server meshing working, call me an optimist, it's certainly got a place in my fleet. It's going to be useful at some point, that's for sure. And that is the second to last ship, guys. We've got one more, and I didn't need this ship, but I was so heavily impressed with this new alien ship from Gattak, the Sulan. Absolutely wonderful, wonderfully engineered ship. Just, this ship, honestly, is fantastic. For $60, I think, a starter ship with 6 SEU of cargo. It looks incredible. All of the sounds are incredible. The animations are superb. The fact that it has a unique bridge cockpit area which points towards the ceiling. Everything about this ship is amazing. Absolutely amazing. I was blown away by just how much effort, time and detail has gone into this start ship. It is absolutely superb. If you haven't tried these, or tried one, or you know someone that has, ask to borrow it, because you will be amazed about how much detail is in this ship. It's great fun. It has tons of firepower. For a starter ship, you know, 3 size 3s is pretty respectable. It's just such a great ship. It sounds great. It's a fantastic little daily driver. It has very good range for its size. I am a little bit biased though, because I am a little bit of an alien fanboy, to be honest, but it's such a good ship. I've been flying it a lot. Last time I flew it, actually, I can't remember what I had. I had something illegal. I found some illegal drugs in the back of a ship that I blew up. It was an AI ship. And I thought, I'll just go sell that then. And then I landed at a scrapyard. And, got murdered by everyone. So that was cool. They're like 3 dudes to jump me from nowhere and murdered me and then took my ship. So I was quite, you know, sad. But it is what it is. I like those moments. Those moments are great. But anyway, the Sulan's fantastic. I mean, look at this. As you can see now, the cockpit is incredible. We have like RGB lighting around these separate MFDs. They're incredible. The entire ship is like that internally. You know, the bathroom, you get a bed, you get storage under the bed. It has the best gun rack in the game, in my opinion. The gun rack in this ship looks amazing, and the fact that they've put so much detail into a little star like this really makes me wonder what CIG are capable of when it comes to the Banu merchantman, which is obviously a whole different animal. But if they can build ships like this, then we're in for a treat. So this ship is going to stay for now, unless they make another alien ship which is equally awesome as this one. The Sulan, highly recommend it to anyone. So there we go, guys. That is my fleet as it stands. So the only thing that's going to change, that might, Polaris is a big if, because I just don't know if I'll be capable and or have the ability to run that ship. So that's kind of on the chopping block. We'll see. If it does, it will be swapped for a Liberator and a Crucible Waiting for the Crucible rework, as I said. Apart from that, this fleet as it stands now is pretty much the final product. I don't really want to change any more. I'm very happy with it. I say this, but then CIG will release something that's even more awesome. So we'll have to wait and see, but as it stands, this is my fleet. So there we go, guys. That was my video on my fleet 2.0. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, you know what buttons to press. Please feel free to join my Discord, and I will have more Star Citizen content en route to your location very soon. Thanks for watching, guys. Take care. Cheers.